The soldiers destroyed my banana and coffee bean fields. They took all my livestock and destroyed all my buildings. I lost everything.
Amina Dabu Kasoma, a small farmer from Uganda, is haunted by his family's violent eviction from their home.
First, I thought that war had broken out. Then we heard that a white man wanted to grow coffee beans there.
The man the Kasomas are talking about lives in Hamburg and is the owner of a coffee empire. Michael R. Neumann is the world's leading importer of unroasted coffee beans. This is what happened when he set up a plantation in Uganda. We've come to Mubende in southwestern Uganda. It's a fertile region that's home to small farmers who grow bananas, avocados, pineapple, and above all, coffee beans. The climate is perfect for coffee, which is why in the year 2001, the Neumann Coffee Group decided to establish a new plantation in the area. The Ugandan government found the perfect site, but the land was already occupied. Hans Fessler from Switzerland is the plantation's manager. He's overseen it right from its inception.
You could see that there were settlements and fields scattered across the land. We knew people were here. That was no secret.
The small farmers had been living there for a long time, some for generations, and had a claim to the land, but their rights were ignored.
We watched as a military vehicle full of soldiers came, and then a second vehicle with civilians. They wore no uniforms and were armed with cudgels and sticks. They ran from house to house yelling, "Everyone out immediately."
No film footage exists of people being driven out of Mubende. But such accounts square with what has happened in other parts of Uganda.
Anyone who tried to get their belongings from their homes was beaten with sticks. The children were afraid and ran away in every direction. Some people tried to save their goats and other belongings, but they didn't know how. They had to leave their chickens behind too. Then they set fire to my beehives and my house.
The soldiers burnt down whole villages and pillaged livestock and food supplies.
I was able to save this photo. I had it in my pocket when they drove us away. We're standing in front of my house. I had the photo taken earlier. The only thing I was able to save from the house was this radio.
Tomwina's wife, Betty, lived with her parents back then. She says that her mother begged the soldiers, who were stealing their livestock, to leave them at least one cow, but they beat her instead.
They demolished houses with a bulldozer. My father was hit with stones when we tried to get him out of the house. He survived for 3 days. Then he died.
Betty Ingabira's mother also died 2 months later of injuries suffered from blows to her kidneys.
After that, we camped out under trees. They gave us vouchers for food, but sometimes there was nothing to eat. There were 6 of us children. We were so hungry that the 2 youngest ones died. Then there were only 4 of us.
Like many of those driven from their homes, Betty now has no choice but to work on the plantation. There's no other work.
Our life today isn't very nice. Every time I work at the plantation and come to the place where we used to live, I have to cry.
Amina Dabu Kasoma's family also used to be able to make ends meet, but they lost everything when they were evicted.
The soldiers came with a backhoe and destroyed everything. They tore our house down, too, as we were fleeing.
Land grabs are a huge problem in Africa. Small farmers' ownership of their properties is seldom officially registered.
The first night, we tried to return to our village and salvage whatever we could from our houses. But the soldiers kept shooting. None of us dared to return again.
This photo is all that remains from better days in the past.
It was very difficult to feed our family. We didn't have any blankets, and we didn't have enough to eat. One of my children died at the age of only 7.
Did the Neumann Coffee Group know what was going on?
I think that not everything went the way it should have. Certainly, pressure was exerted. I think it's possible that the army, which was already present here, intervened.
Possible? It's hard to imagine the company knew nothing of the many people being driven from their homes to make room for the Kaweri coffee plantation.
The Neumann firm provides services and products along the whole value chain of green coffee production. We began farming with the intention of establishing environmentally renewable plantations in all senses of that term.
Bio-corridors were set up to protect wildlife diversity on this model farm. Environmental sustainability is one of the Neumann Coffee Group's major selling points. Neumann Coffee Group is located in the upscale port district in Hamburg. It controls 10% of the world's raw coffee market and supplies some of Germany's best-known brands. It has 46 subsidiaries in 28 countries and did $2.7 billion in business in 2014. The name Neumann appears everywhere in the coffee sector. Peter Kayira has taken on the corporate giant in Uganda. The former school director is the spokesman for people driven from their homes in Mubende.
Having all those other avenues blocked, the only passage we thought that is now still available is the court passage to get back our land.
The Neumann firm claims only 50 families used to live on the plantation land.
I arrived a few days later and noticed that something had gone on. It must have been pretty harsh. But 2,000 people? There were never 2,000 people living here.
Kayira filed a complaint on behalf of all the people evicted from their homes. 4,000 people from 4 villages, he says.
But some people said that poor people like we could not take government to court. So some refused to register with me. But I registered 2,041 people.
The dispossessed were helped by the human rights organization Food First Information and Actions Network, or FIAN.
The Kaweri plantation is one of the first cases of land grabbing that's well documented. Multinational corporations and governments are taking people's land away to produce goods for export.
Gertrude Falk has been helping the dispossessed since 2003 and is regularly in Uganda.
FIAN supports people's right to feed themselves. In the case of the Kaweri plantation, the Ugandan government, with support from the Neumann company, clearly violated this right. Land was taken from the local populace, and they couldn't feed themselves.
Some of the dispossessed come together in the village school. They're hoping for some good news in the conflict, which has been going on for 10 years. The lawyers from FIAN International say the Ugandan government is responsible as well.
The Ugandan government has really violated its laws. The constitution is very clear. Ugandans, people, have the right to settle anywhere in Uganda. So once they settle, they have rights on the land. These people, in Mubende case, they were bona fide tenants. The owner of the land accepted that these people are living in its land. They live there for a long time, they pay tax, they live there peacefully, they could feed themselves.
The Fian representatives are trying to arrange a meeting with the German ambassador to Uganda.
The ambassador should help us get out of this miserable situation. He should talk to those responsible. They should compensate us and give us our land back.
When they reached in the coffee plantation, they took them photos that they are thieves. And in reality, they just take them without coffee. And when are these things real? When are they going to end? Our people are being taken minus with the local leaders who are nearby the coffee. We don't have rights, we don't have powers. They are taking our people to prison for nothing.
Some of the school furniture reads donated by Kaweri. Neumann highlights its support for the new school. What the company doesn't say is that it converted the old one into plantation offices and that children had to go without instruction for a year. This is Ananandiosa Katende. She's 83 years old. She lived here all of her life until she was driven from her home. All she has left is a small plot of land where she lives with her daughters and grandchildren. Anna used to own 6 houses, more than 100 animals, and 42 hectares of land. Then, on August 18, 2001, the soldiers came.
They burned down the stall where my goats were. The goats were all burned to death. It's dreadful. I can't help crying when I think of it. After that, I had to camp out under the trees. I had nothing. I put a straw mat on the ground and leaned up against a tree. I couldn't sleep. The soldiers kept moving around, circling us. They patrolled here for 5 days. This land belongs to me. I inherited it from my father. These papers prove that my father bought this land. He was alive back then. He signed these papers in 1964.
The documents also show that Anna's land doesn't belong to the plantation's Block 99. It's part of Block 103.
As they were surveying land known as Block 99 Buekula, they encroached on Block 103. It is not a slight mistake, because the part they took measures 2 square miles. This map you see is contained in a research report by Makerere University. They had it that part of the plantation really is part of Block 103. And this is an official map from the Departments of Land and Survey, Entebbe. This shows you the boundaries of the land. You see, these circles show the stones which were buried inside the soil by the surveyors who made the boundaries. So it can be proven.
Another villager also has a receipt for the purchase of the land that was stolen from him.
These are my arguments which prove that I own the land on Block 103. But afterwards, I was evicted, forcibly evicted from that land.
This area was resurveyed in 2012, and the surveyors said the boundaries were correct. But doubts remain. What about Anna's deed and title? Peter Kayira is taking some visitors through the 2,500-hectare plantation, Uganda's biggest and most modern. This is a public road, but there's a checkpoint at every crossing. Peter says it's painful to pass by the plot of land that used to belong to him. Ever since 2002, he's been trying to get the dispossessed to sue the Ugandan government and Kaweri Plantation.
We were one of the oldest families in this land. It is my great-grandfather who had settled in this land.
This is where my home used to be before the eviction. So my house was just there. And this is my compound. I had something more than 2,000 plants of coffee. I was the person who was leading the people to refuse to go. Then they ordered the army when they came to kill me. But one of the soldiers was my friend. He said, no, should not die. So I got message. So I ran away. They wanted to arrest the wife. The wife ran away. They destroyed the house and looted every property. So I lost everything.
We're in Kiengeza, the village of the dispossessed. After the military drove them from their land, many people fled into the woods and resettled near the plantation. All they had over their heads were sheets of plastic. There was no clean water or medical care. Some later built houses, but other families still live in wretched conditions. Clay huts are all that many people have for shelter. Poverty and malnutrition are rife here.
I used to have my own land, and we used to have enough to eat. I had my own home and livestock. We were safe and secure. Today, I have to rely on others' help. I've become a refugee.
They always say we'll be compensated and be given land elsewhere, but we're still waiting. So far, we've been given nothing.
The government says these people have been compensated. We meet up with the highest-ranking government official in the area.
I'm sure these families were not really evicted. These families agreed, and they were compensated. And they left the land willingly.
Willingly. So is the story of villagers being driven off their land a lie? Village elder Patrick Segwato recalls how white men arrived and summoned him for a meeting.
I went in my function as a village elder. They said they were bringing progress to the village and promised that we would be compensated for our lost homes and property. We would be given equally good land elsewhere. They said they were going to build new roads, hospitals, and water wells. They said we were going to live in a promised land. But as sure as I'm sitting here today, those promises were never kept.
John Patrick Kiambade is another village elder. He says the dispossessed were given 50,000 shillings compensation, 30 euros.
You cannot give a person who has been having land of 10 acres, has been having a house, he has been having his animals, has been having what all of that, and you give him 50,000. I'm saying, and sincerely speaking, these people, although they are saying that these people were not compensated at all, many of these people don't know how to read and write. They don't know English. These forms were written in English. So they would come, you want to get your money, you come and sign.
The Neumann company says the dispossessed were adequately compensated and that the process was correctly documented.
The village elders signed the documents. So did lawyers for both the sellers and the state. We had no reason to question that, and we still don't.
We head to the Ugandan capital, Kampala, to meet the village's attorney. He contradicts Hans Fessler. He says people were coerced into signing the compensation documents.
There is an assistant RDC who was going around the villages, escorted by army soldiers, forcing people to sign that he had been given land elsewhere and that he'd been given compensation.
The lawyer says Neumann employees were complicit in this process.
Yes, brother, can you give me that? Immediately after the official opening, the employees of Kaweli Coffee Plantation started cutting down all the crops, coffee trees, banana plants,
and everything in the process of clearing the ground for them to start planting their coffee. We sued them because they participated in the actual eviction and destruction of my client's property.
So what did Neumann managers know about the military's role in driving people from the land?
I can well imagine that they exerted pressure to move the resettlement and compensation process forward. But we would have known about it if the army had moved in and started threatening people.
What's clear is that on the eve of the evictions, everyone concerned met up, including two Neumann managers.
They were in that meeting when the representative of the government gave the evictees the ultimatum. They had to leave before 8 a.m. the following morning. So they can't be innocent. They're not innocent.
The dispossessed have been waiting a long time for justice, but they haven't made any progress with their lawsuits against Kaweri Plantation and the Ugandan state.
The courts and the state prosecutor have used every trick in the book to drag out the trial. And the Neumann company has done everything possible to slow things down. We urgently need legal avenues to sue companies like this, particularly in industrialized nations. Parent companies skim off the profits, but they're not held accountable when their subsidiaries violate the law.
Für die Rechtsverletzungen gerade, die diese Tochterunternehmen verursachen.
The tiny Swiss canton of Zug is almost 6,000 kilometers away from Mubende. It has the lowest tax rate in Switzerland and is home to many multinational corporations and a number of Neumann-owned companies. They include Tropical Farm Management, which runs the Kaweri plantation. We meet up with an expert who served as the president of the Swiss Coffee Dealers Association for 14 years. Walter Zwald knows what he's talking about.
Neumann is giving the coffee industry a bad name. The company should have owned up to what happened long ago and admitted that it made a mistake. They should have investigated how the land was truly obtained. Obviously, it's difficult to get established in countries like this, but you can do things the right way. It's shameful for one of the world's leading coffee companies to be involved in something like this.
Zwald says what happened in Mubende is widely known in the industry, but it's not discussed publicly. He says others need to hold Neumann accountable.
Industry organizations should have told Neumann a long time ago, you are not allowed to use our labels anymore.
Du kannst unser Label nicht mehr gebrauchen.
Wageningen University in the Netherlands. UN Special Rapporteur on the Right to Food, Olivier de Schutter, is speaking to an international conference. He knows about Mubende and questions Neumann's behavior.
This company should become accustomed to the new corporate culture that is now expected from companies throughout the world. And that corporate culture is one in which they should respect human rights by acting with due diligence to seek information about the impacts of their activities. And if these impacts are negative, they should remedy them.
Uganda, late March 2013. A court issues a long-awaited ruling, finding that people were driven from their land in Mubende. It holds Neumann partially responsible and awards damages of 11 million euros. Oddly, Neumann's lawyers, who were not named in the suit, are the ones ordered to pay the money. Still, activists applaud the ruling.
This ruling is a milestone in dispossessed people's battle for compensation. It's the first court decision at all in 11 years. The judge supported the view and arguments of the dispossessed. He analyzed this case very carefully and was very thorough in his arguments as well.
April 2014. We return to Mubende. It's a year after the court ruling. Neumann has lodged an appeal, and the dispossessed are still waiting for compensation. Aminadabu Kasoma had hoped the matter could be resolved quickly, He wants to send his son Eriya to university, but he can't afford the fees. He says he could if his land had not been taken away.
I still have hope. I hope that as long as the court hears our case and we're able to defend ourselves, then the truth will emerge. Even if it does take a long time, and even if we have to continue waiting.
The High Court in Kampala. We have an appointment with the judge, Aup Singh Chowdhury. Even before his ruling in the Mubende case, he was active in drawing attention to corruption in Uganda.
It is a wake-up call, so that there's no violation of human rights, particularly in such cases where innocent people have been evicted from their homes. I think it was incumbent upon them to ensure that they did not move into the land until those people were relocated and until they were compensated. They did not do that, but they were quietly watching the drama, knowing full well what was happening. So that is what I had to make those harsh remarks, because they had lost all sense of humanity.
Peter Kayira calls the ruling a belated acknowledgement of both his own and other people's suffering.
When we won the case, actually, the people were very happy. Everyone was very happy. They did not think, actually, that we could come to that success so soon.
Kayira served as the spokesperson for the dispossessed for many years. He was subject to slander and was imprisoned for 5 months on trumped-up charges.
When I was in prison, they sent 3 messengers to me saying that if I was willing to drop the case I had sued the company, they also dropped the case against me. Even now, when I am moving, I know that there is a very big eye following me. But I have nothing to do. I have nothing to do, and I will not give up.
But although the court ruled in their favor, the dispossessed are still fighting for justice.
We appealed that the government should also be punished for commanding the army to evict us.
Neumann says that the ruling is a crass miscarriage of justice, which is why the company is also appealing. But no one wants to talk in front of the camera. Neumann prefers written statements. Neumann's legal representative in Kampala, however, is willing to be interviewed. He questions the judge's competence and seeks to shift the blame for the evictions.
This jailbird, he mobilized the people for purposes of trying to extort somebody who had come to do investment, probably with an aim of getting some money, which would be unjust enrichment.
Whom are you talking about?
I'm talking about Peter Baleke Kayira. Yes.
Is the real perpetrator masquerading as one of the victims? Kayira will later tell us that this is a lie intended to discredit him.
He has gone on to confuse people that people were evicted from the land. No, they were not. In fact, they were compensated by buying alternative land, and they went.
Alternative land? We meet up with the village elder at Kambuye, the site where people were supposedly given compensatory property. But 13 years on, there is no sign of the promised houses, roads, or well. The land wasn't even cleared, we're told. So it was impossible for people to live here.
They give them some tents where to reside. They give them food for 3 months. They had brought the bowls if the people came. So the people didn't come.
This land was only cleared recently, and documents show that it could not have been given to the dispossessed villagers in 2001 because the state hadn't even bought it yet. It only changed hands in 2010. The radio station Heart FM is located on the outskirts of Mubende. Peter Kayira is a popular guest here. He's often invited to talk about political topics. Today he's here to tell listeners about the issue closest to his heart, the Mubende case, and to demand his rights under the Ugandan Land Act. Then he makes his way again to Kampala to consult with his attorney. There's news, and it's not good. Another setback.
We have a problem with the original court files. It's reported missing. They are looking for it. I've written several letters complaining about the loss of the file.
It takes 6 months for the files, containing around 4,000 pages, to reappear. Kayira and his attorneys say that this is another attempt to stall the case.
This case should be a lesson to government and foreign investors that however much we want investment, we must respect rights, human rights of Ugandans.
Back in Mubende, guards have stepped up their surveillance at the checkpoints, even though this is a public road. The following day, our camera team is threatened. We'll be thrown in jail, and our footage will be confiscated, we're told, because we filmed the plantation's office from the road. 3,500 tons of coffee beans are harvested every year on the plantation, Kayira tells us. Some of them go to Germany. Day laborers line the road. They earn an average of €1 per day, they say. That places them just above the absolute poverty level, as defined by the World Bank.
They refuse to raise our pay. We get very little to eat, just enough to keep us from starving. We get corn groats every evening, and it has to last us until the following evening. There's nothing to eat during the day, only in the evening. We sleep on the site over there on bare metal. There are no mattresses or mats.
In the meantime, another year has gone by. The dispossessed who had hoped for a quick settlement are angry and disappointed. Spring 2015, Hamburg. Peter Kayira is once again trying to advance the victim's cause.
Mr. Mike Newman came at the beginning of this year at the plantation, stayed there for something like 2 weeks, but did not take any initiative to talk to the community or to talk to me or to talk to anybody in the local authorities. Actually, this would be an opportune time because they have always said they want to talk.
Kayira tried to arrange a meeting with the head of the company, but received no answer. Someday, they'll have to talk to us, he says. They can't refuse forever. A few days later in Geneva, the seat of the second largest United Nations office after its headquarters in New York, Gertrude Falk and Peter Kayira are attending a meeting of the UN Committee on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights. It's scheduled to take up the case of Mubende this week.
At least the international level, we have been able to reach there. Because when you speak it, down there in Chenges, our village, people cannot understand that we really can't make it to Geneva, but now I'm there.
Fionn is accredited at the UN, so it can help the victims make their case. That's one of the main things her organization does, says Gertrude Falk. The committee meets in the venerable Palais Wilson. The next session is devoted to human rights in Uganda. NGOs are getting prepared.
Because the committee is now working in a general comment on the transnational companies' issues, your case will be a good example on why we need these new standards.
The committee's mandate is to ensure that people's economic, social, and cultural rights are respected. It collects information both from governments and non-governmental groups. Fionn and Peter Kayira have submitted testimony.
I told the committee members that the eviction was brutal and there was no compensation given. The evicted community did not have an alternative for survival, and the conditions of living are growing worse and worse every day. first and foremost, they must make a recommendation for a restitution to our land, because it is only means of survival we can have.
We have high hopes from the committee, which makes recommendations to the Ugandan government and can put the state under pressure to act. We want the dispossessed people's court case to proceed and for a solution to be finally found.
Later, the final report of the committee will call upon the Ugandan government to restore the villagers' land as soon as possible. Back in Uganda, there is a new development. In July 2015, an appeals court overturns the judge's ruling and sends the case back to the High Court. Attorney Joseph Balikundembe says that land cases take a long time in Uganda, but rarely as long as this.
This case has been delayed for a number of reasons, and some of it is, pressure from outside, which you could call political, because the government is being embarrassed by this case.
Kampala, August 2016. It's the 15th anniversary of the evictions. The Fian workers have returned to Uganda to mark the occasion and help the victims.
Because when they go to court, sometimes they breach.
At a press conference in Kampala, Peter Kayira tells reporters about a new attempt being made to divide the dispossessed. Some people have been promised financial compensation if they renounce their claims to land.
It is not threatening to our case. Actually, it is only concretizing what we have always been claiming, that the people, we, were not compensated.
His hopes have been boosted by the discovery of a map showing that the plantation simply annexed a part of Block 103.
When they came here, instead of going northwards like this, they surveyed southeastwards through here, going here like this. Therefore, they grabbed all this piece.
We return to Kiengeza. How have things developed in the past 2 years? Have the living conditions of the dispossessed improved? It's the rainy season, and the going is tough. Kiengeza. At first glance, there are a few people peddling wares and more small shops. But otherwise, little has changed, 15 years on from the evictions. The German activists are particularly interested this time around in the situation of dispossessed women and children. They are still waiting for justice to be done.
The dispossessed sued in August 2002, and 14 years later, in August 2016, there's still been no final ruling in the case. You can only call this a denial of justice and legal protection.
Gertrude Falk began researching the situation of women among dispossessed families 18 months ago. The results of her investigation are shocking. Despite claims that people would be better off, the plantation's impact has been overwhelmingly negative. Anyone who could has moved away. Those left behind are mostly children and the elderly.
Living conditions are catastrophic. They've gotten worse in the past few years, I'd say. People have no land to grow crops on, so they go hungry. As a result, children either don't go to school or are unable to concentrate if they do. The number of girls getting pregnant at the age of 13 or 14 has increased enormously. And many of the girls are infected with HIV.
Many families can only afford one meal a day, these women tell us. And they need to be on their guard to avoid having it stolen by the underpaid plantation workers. In partnership with the Kaweri plantation, it says at the entrance to the local school, Valentin Hatigekimana is trying to collect information about the children of the dispossessed.
The boy said his friend is no longer in the school because the parents can't afford school fees, and that boy is working at the Kaweri coffee plantation. After 15 years of this forced eviction, the suffering is still really going on in these communities, and you can see it through the kids.
A sobering conclusion. And yet, people here still haven't given up hope that justice will someday be served. On the outskirts of Kiengese, the community has built a new church. Peter Kayira has called a meeting to mark the 15th anniversary of the evictions. Everyone in the village, not just the dispossessed, has come to hear the latest about the court case.
The 15 years have been years of struggle, but they have been years of learning. And the learning is still continuous. Many people have learned from me, as I also learned from other friends and organizations. So many people are taking up their cases now to court. They did not know that it could happen.
There have been repeated attempts from the outside to quash the resistance in Kiengese, Kayira says. Bribes have been offered. Corruption is rampant in Uganda, including in the government.
I told them, I'll make them bring back what they have destroyed. That is the promise I made with the people. And I will never drop that promise. I'll never betray the people. That's the only drive, the driving factor in my heart.
Peter Kayira shows people his map. This new piece of evidence stirs their hopes. People in Kiengese still believe that their cause will triumph. They believe that future generations will again be able to live on the land their families once owned.